2 years as Lieutenant Governor, 8 years as our Attorney General, and 4 years as the United States Attorney for South Carolina under Ronald Reagan. Married to Peggy McMaster, they have 2 children, Henry Jr. and Mary Rogers McMaster. Governor's here to provide you not a political but a speech, but an update on South Carolina, where we are and where we're going. He just did the State of the State message a couple of weeks ago. Allow me just a few highlights. His first year in office. Business? Pretty darn good. South Carolina has added more than 17,000 new jobs from over 127 development projects, nearly $5 billion in new capital investment. And by the way, we just spent the hour before coming here up at ASCO looking at, the governor was touring their operations there, and they are expanding, adding more employees and construction projects, 2 phases of construction that's going on there. The governor this past year issued a double-digit tax cut for small businesses, cutting the unemployment insurance rate by 10.2%. Yeah, all right. Yeah. Our small business people. He took aim at the burdensome regulations by issuing an executive order requiring state agencies to use the rotary four-way test when it comes to regulations. The governor's a longtime member, by the way, of the Columbia Rotary Club. He declared a state of emergency recently for the opiate crisis and created an emergency response team to combat that fast-growing silent hurricane of addiction. He's deeply involved in helping solve our nuclear financial meltdown, no thanks to SCANA and the Santee Cooper executives, not their employees, their executives. And he spent so much time in Washington in recent days that at the Department of Energy that Rick Perry's staff is calling him Mr. SRS. And that's music to your ears over here, isn't it? Please join me in giving a rousing rotary welcome to the governor of South Carolina, Henry McMaster.
She's going to the upstate to meet with some friends today at a little meeting. But a few months ago, I was on the way to the Republican convention in Cleveland. And y'all, I'm a Republican, so Marshall, I was going to the Republican convention. That's customary. You go to the one. Anyway, I was on the way and I called Peggy and said, Peggy, did you ever in your wildest dream see your husband Henry nominate Donald Trump at the Republican National Convention? She says, Henry, I hate to tell you, I never seen you in any of my wildest dreams. she's enjoying being the first lady. And I'll tell you, if you have not been to the State House or to the governor's mansion lately, you ought to go and take a look. The State House hadn't changed much in the last 15 or so years because it had big renovation, but it is absolutely beautiful. Various positions, I've had a chance to go around the country and look at other buildings. I don't think there's a prettier one than the one we have. It's elegant, it's well made. In fact, those, all kind of little facts, those columns out front are the longest columns, the tallest, I think, in the world, made from a single cut of stone. They're, I think, about 2 feet taller than the ones in Athens there at the Parthenon. We've got all sorts of hidden treasures like that over South Carolina that a lot of us don't recognize. But the mansion itself is on 9 acres and it is just as beautiful. There are 3 buildings there and they go way back. They're all antebellum. And of course it was the Arsenal Academy where I think the first year class of those going into the military, they were the Civil War later, the first year when the academy got burned, Sherman came through, but the mansion itself was left because the officers stayed there. Since then, it's been added on to, but everything that's been done to it has been done carefully, with great thought, and with great skill, and it is absolutely magnificent, and you ought to see it. But that approach to taking care of those buildings is the approach that I like to see in taking care of business in South Carolina. That is, you be careful. The old carpenter's rule is, you measure twice and cut once. Don't go too fast. Take your time and get it right. And ladies and gentlemen, I'm here to tell you that in the positions that Bill Taylor mentioned, particularly as lieutenant governor and now as governor for the last year, I've been able to meet the people from all over the world that are interested in coming to South Carolina. I've met some of them before, as you probably have traveling around. Part of this job is to meet these people, and they are thrilled with what they see in South Carolina. We are on the way up, and we got a full head of steam. What we have to do is be sure that we don't slow it down. We don't make any mistakes. As they would say in equestrian circles, you don't rein your horse in when he's jumping. You let him go. So we got to let South Carolina go. And I believe if we encourage the people and we use the assets that we have, that there's just no stopping South Carolina. We were talking earlier that we sometimes refer to as the beast of the Southeast. Well, they're talking about industrial and manufacturing development, and it's coming all over the place. And those are great jobs. One of the main things, I'll ask you to help me do this, the main things we have to do in our state to see that we achieve our fullest potential is to convince the people that these manufacturing jobs that don't require a four-year college degree are great jobs. We just open it. They don't carry toolboxes and have greasy clothing anymore in these big manufacturing plants. You can wear tuxedos and do that work. They have laptops, they have computers, and the jobs pay very well. And you can go straight, you can go from high school to one of the technical colleges and get a degree or a start on a degree, and then go work in that plant. And before you know it, you're a young person, you can be making plenty of money. And if you want to go back and finish that degree, if you want to get a four-year degree, which a lot of times is required for management, it's easy to do. You can go online and do that around here now. But our technical college system, we have somebody from the technical college system is here. That's the president. I'm glad you're here. If everything I'm saying is true, is that right?
Yes, sir. Amen and hallelujah.
We started our technical college system in 1961. There are other states that are just getting started. They have a few here and there. We got 16. But that is an asset that you can't make it overnight. But the biggest thing we have is a cultural problem. We have to make sure that the parents understand that those young people, those children, they're on the way up. They want to use, just like a surgeon, they want to use their brains and their hands. They can go into these plants, and before you know it, they'll be making good money. We got 20 and 21-year-olds buying homes, getting married. And ladies and gentlemen, a good job, a good paying job, doing something you like to do, is the cure for most every problem we have. It affects education. Mike Hunt, who's, by the way, has done a terrific job. Last time Mike and I, Sheriff, spent a lot of time together, was back in Granite. And unfortunately, we just saw almost a repeat of that not long ago. That we got a lot of work to do in making things better. But Sheriff Hunt would agree that if you have somebody that's happily married, that's got a good job, they usually don't end up getting arrested. They're usually not on the end of a gun getting arrested and marched down to the police headquarters or the sheriff's office. Poverty is the enemy of education. I want to say it again. Poverty is the enemy of education. So how do you get rid of poverty? Well, you have to have, essentially, you got to have good teachers and good principals. Very often it is not a question of money. The recent Supreme Court case analyzed all the money and said it's not a question of money. It's a question of consolidating school districts and saving money. It's a question of having the very best principals, the very best teachers that we can bring. A lot of our young teachers do not want to go to some of our rural areas. Why is that? That's because there's just nothing to do there. They just can't go. They won't, they move for a while, but they won't stay. Not long ago, I was in Lee County talking to the superintendent of education. Lee County's got 19,000 people. The biggest industries are the school district and the waste dump right there on I-20, if you see it as you go by. That's where most of the money is. People get out of high school and leave. People are leaving. I asked her, what would happen if you had a company, let's say the size of Astra, let's say someone with 300, 400, 500 employees come into the town and set up in Bishopville, somewhere in Lee County, what would happen? She dropped her pencil, took off her glasses, said it'd change everything. People who've left would come back. People who are here would not leave. It would change the whole society, change everything in Lee County. Well, that's what we have the opportunity to do right now, because companies all over this world are looking at South Carolina. Economic development, education, public safety, all very big issues, but economic development is the one that builds the core and upon which all else depends. So our technical college system of answers to that, and I've introduced ideas and proposals to where we streamline the process so you can get dual degrees, where students in high school will be introduced to what's going on in the plants, where there be a smooth transition. And if we can get that done, we can change South Carolina even faster, even more for the better. I want to recognize some of the folks. As I said, there are a lot of folks here that are deeply involved in a lot of things, but you got about half the legislature here. Back there somewhere. Tom's always kind of in the back. I presided over the Senate for 2 years, and he sat in the back then. I got to tell you, Tom, stand up, let him look at you. That's one of the finest things we've ever had. Also, Bill Taylor's here. Bill, where's Bill Clyburn? Bill Clyburn's here. Mark Blackwell's here. Mark Blackwell, Ronnie Young. Yes, sir, over there, there's Ronnie. And we already saw the mayor. Glad the mayor's here. I want to ask a question. What do you think is the most important issue we have facing us here in South Carolina? Is it public safety? Is it jobs? Is it roads? Is it the environment? Is it keeping the place clean, keeping the place safe? Well, the answer is it's all of those things. So it takes leadership, it takes a team to get all of those things done. And there's Marshall Kane there. Marshall was in the legislature a long time ago. I know and he did a grand job and was a real leader. Ladies and gentlemen, y'all may not know, but until 1962, there weren't any Republicans in the state legislature. They were in the legislative manual. In the legislative manual, they have R's and D's by everybody's name now who's holding the public office in the state government. And until 1962, there were no R's and no D's. That's because everybody was a Democrat. But in 1962, there was one Republican who's grown since. So we got a strong two-party system. It's leaning strong for the Republicans right now. But despite your party affiliation, despite what you call yourself, whether you're an independent, we've got opportunity in South Carolina to get things done that nobody else can do. Now, someone mentioned Mr. Trump a minute ago. I got to tell you all this. When I endorsed Mr. Trump way back in 2016, Peggy and I went out to the little farm in Gilbert. The place was packed. It had about 10,000 people, and I made my endorsement, and I was told by his staff that I was the first elected official in the country to endorse Mr. Trump. Well, ladies and gentlemen, by the time the sun came up the next morning, I was a certified moron and idiot, but then you fast forward to election day, and I became a certified genius. Let me get on with this. In economic development, we have got a lot to do. I've mentioned most of those things, but I tell you, in the public schools, one thing we have to do, we have to consolidate those districts, and we've got to be safe. We got to have officers in the schools. I would like in just a few years to have a security officer in every school so that the children don't have to worry and the parents don't have to worry about sending the children to school. And another thing I want to do, Sheriff, we don't have any sanctuary cities in South Carolina. We don't have any. What I would like to do is to have a law that requires the cities and every municipality to certify that they are not serving as a sanctuary city. What's a sanctuary city? That's a place where law enforcement doesn't enforce certain laws, or whether it's on immigration or something else. Well, law enforcement people will tell you, if you have a city, any kind of municipality that does not enforce certain laws and word of that gets out, what happens? More of those kind of people come in. A state that does not enforce its laws is a state that's going to have a lot of laws broken. So we want to pass that legislation that will say to the entire country that in South Carolina, we believe in the rule of law, and if you come here and you break the law, you will be held accountable. We must do that, and I hope we can do it in this legislative session. In addition, we have to work on health care. We know that these companies that are looking at people in South Carolina, if they want to come here, they're looking for healthy people, people that will show up to work. Well, in a lot of our rural areas, there are no doctors. In fact, there are no nurses. There's a bill been introduced that will allow more nurses to work out in the rural areas, more nurses to work in the little medical clinics, the things you see in the grocery, in the, all the stores, a lot of the drug stores. Those are good things, but it's going to take legislation to allow that to expand. Also, we're going to have to make full use of telemedicine. It's real easy. The other day, I had something wrong with my eye, and I picked up the phone and called my eye doctor, and he said, well, can you come in? I said, yes, sure, I can. He said, well, wait a minute, just show me what it looks like. So I put the phone on my eye, and he said, that's no problem. We'll have to come in a few days. That's just told me what it was. Telemedicine. If we can have the nurses and doctors providing their talents and their abilities through telemedicine and through their presence, where you don't have to have a doctor. It's hard to get doctors to go to some of these rural areas. We do have nurses that are willing to go. But if we can do those things, we can help keep people healthy. Let me finish up by telling you what I hear from these companies that come here. I've been very pleased to hear what they say. We've got great research universities in our state. We have three of them. And they work with each other. That's very unusual. And these are high, USC, Clemson, and MUSC. And also we have a good four-year and two-year system in addition. And these people that come here know that. They also know we have plentiful electrical power. Now we've run into a little bump in the road on that, and I can answer some questions. But here's the good news on the scanner, the meltdown of the construction at the nuclear site, almost two reactors, we have one that's already been there for a long time, is we've had companies from all over the country, even a few from other countries, calling, wanting information, wanting to meet about coming to South Carolina and buying or investing or getting involved in South Carolina. Everybody wants to come to the South, and the place that's moving the fastest in the South, according to everybody, is South Carolina. But they're interested in the supply of power, they're interested in the research universities, they're thrilled with the notion of these technical colleges. This is the only state in the country that if you're in some foreign country or another part of this country and you're interested in building your plant here, we will send a team from a technical college or a group of technical colleges to that country at no charge to look at their operations to see what it takes to do the kind of work that they do, see what kind of training and education you need, come back to South Carolina and set it up right here for free for that country, for that company, to train their people if they're willing to come here and invest money. Nobody else does that in the whole country. And one more thing, going on at Clemson University right now, there's a program that fits right into this. This is the new paradigm. The combination of a big company that relies on a lot of research, a technical college, and a research university. Those three, that's the future. That's where we're going, and we have it in abundance. At Clemson University right now, just to pick one, the same things at Carolina, they're doing it at MUSC. But at Clemson, there's a program there where you have researchers from, I think it's BMW, who are working there with PhDs at Clemson, and master's candidates, PhD candidates, bachelor's candidates, also technical college students and candidates, and also they're bringing in high school students with dual enrollment, all working on inventions. Right now, I think it's mainly on automotive. That is not only the only place in the country that does that. That's from all the way from high school through heavy research with PhDs. It's the only place in the world, as far as anyone knows. That's how far ahead we are of these other places. But what else do we have? We've got a magnificent port. It's deep water. In just a few years, the Port of South Carolina and the Port of New York, New Jersey will be the two dominant ports on the Atlantic coast, and the way things are working, I'm betting that it's going to be made and coming here, and in just a few years, we'll open up Jasper, and we will be so far ahead of everybody else. And I got to say, Lindsey Graham went to work on that port. Lindsey Graham is working hard on Savannah River, and he is he's a great asset himself with the work that he's doing. So what else are they looking at? The port, the power, the technical college system, research. I've heard it said many times, and now I'll tell you almost in the same exact words. Say the things that we are most interested in, the thing that sells us the most on South Carolina is the people of South Carolina. Sir, what do you mean, Mr. Chairman of BMW? What do you mean? He says the people of South Carolina show that this is a handshake state. What do you mean? He said, when someone in South Carolina gives you their word and shakes your hand, they will keep it. I've heard that many, many times. Now, that's something we all know how friendly we are. And that surprises a lot of people. I've had a lot of these folks say, I was walking down the street in Aiken, and the total stranger came up and said, how are you doing this morning, sir? Said, that doesn't happen to me where I come from. Well, it happens all over the place here. But this is a handshake state, and that is dramatically important to these people who want to invest millions and hundreds of millions of dollars. Just a few other things we have to do. To finish up, in the nuclear field, Savannah River projects, all of them, mocks, we got a lot of work to do. And I've spent time with Secretary Perry, and also with the Deputy Secretary Brugette and his staff. We've had a number of meetings. I've spoken to the President about it some time ago, and it is an imperative that we have the MOX facility working. It's an imperative that we open up the Advanced Manufacturing Center, which, according to the information I'm getting, is coming pretty close. We're about to get there. But it's important also that we open up Yucca. When I was the Attorney General, we brought the lawsuit to open up Yucca. We won the lawsuit, but the way it ended up was as long as there was no funding for Yucca, then the Department of Energy could not be required to go through with it. Well, there's funding now under President Trump. So what we need to do is be sure that funding is increased and that gets done. But also with the MOX facility, there is no good alternative to the MOX facility. But there are a lot of folks still in Washington who have the mentality that was in the position that was throughout the Obama administration that is an anti-nuclear power. So we still have to overcome some of that. But the good news is that it's turning. So we've got a lot of work to do. I want to leave you with, be happy and be proud of South Carolina, because we've come from so much. We've gone through everything. We've been starting in 1670. We've been through every war, hurricanes, floods, everything. And here we are. And we are strong. And we are, right now, we are the envy of the rest of the country when it comes to economic development and the quality of life. And that's something we need to be very proud of. And if we, just the people in this room, if everybody in this room, if we had the talent, all the talent just in this room that was focused on getting that done, we can duplicate this around the state. I know we haven't done it in any time. But y'all, thank you very much for having me here. I'm proud to be here. I'm delighted with what's going on. I'm delighted with the economic growth and the happiness of the people. And to quote that great philosopher, Tim McGraw, also a country music singer, I like it, I love it, I want some more of it.
think we've got some time for the governor to take a couple of questions for you before he has to take off the parts unknown.
So. I'll do it. Questions?
Well, they're not that bad. Really, they're not.
Is anybody from the ORS going to be held responsible for the scan of mass?
I don't know. I think there's a lot of responsibility to go around for the scan of mass. One thing that is clear that there's lack of information presented to decision makers. Also, the Office of Regulatory Staff had been hamstrung by legislation and policy over the years in exactly what they could do, the way the laws were written. And while they had wanted, would have been able to exercise more responsibility, they were prohibited from doing so by the way the law's been written, the law's been interpreted. But when, you might remember, I asked for the report that had that at that point been secret, and the entity is Santee Cooper and Scanner, mainly Santee Cooper. Santee Cooper is a state agency, and the governor's in charge of that agency. I have some authority over it. So I asked for a copy of that Bechtel report. They resisted. They didn't want to give it out. And I understand why. After we got it out and showed it to everybody. But that's no way to run an operation. I think there's plenty of bait, blame to go around. There are criminal investigations going on as well right now, I'm told. But that put us in a real mess. I think nuclear power is a big part of our future. I think it's necessary. I think we ought to have all of the above when it comes to power. But it's just a shame at what has happened with those two nuclear reactors. We were worried for a while whether Toshiba would live up on to their agreement, their guarantee of about $2 billion to pay in. But where I am most concerned for the people of South Carolina, number one, we've got to have power in order to operate. The co-ops are all over the state. They've got to have power. We must have power, but also the people that have been paying that money in need to either get those reactors or they need to get the money back. See, you have a monopoly. You've got to buy your power from this company, and that company is adding a fee to pay for these reactors. And the way the law is written, the Base Load Review Act, they're paying for it before they're built, and now they're not going to build. They have to continue paying for it. That's not right.
Aren't we only getting 5% back out of the 20% that we paid?
Well, that is the offer made by Dominion. Dominion is one of several who are interested. I am fairly confident that there will be other offers. There's a lot of negotiation going on right now behind the scenes that you don't hear about. But I've met with several, I guess probably 7 or 8 different folks at our companies who are interested in investing, maybe more than that. And some have said no at first and then came back and said yes, they are interested. So we got a long way to go. But again, this is another instance where we got to know what we're doing. And we don't know the value of those, you know, of Santee Cooper right now. My position on Santee Cooper is we need to sell it. Why is that? It's $8 billion in debt. $4.3 billion is for those nuclear reactors. That is bonded indebtedness. That's not like a mortgage. You've got to pay it. It's bonded indebtedness. That's $4.3 billion. Well, the reactor's not going to be there, it looks like, to make energy to sell to pay off that bond, to pay off that loan. The people are just going to be stuck with it. Well, I don't know how we're going to get $4.3 billion out of the ratepayers buy power from Santee Cooper. So I believe the only answer is to let one of these big organizations, plenty of money, many, multiple times bigger than Santee Cooper and Scanner put together, let's find out exactly what it is worth. But let's go for a high price, of course, and don't sell the lakes. We're not going to sell the lakes and the profit. We're going to keep that. But I think that's the only way to let them handle that debt, not put it on the backs of these customers. They got a lot more customers than we have here in South Carolina. Other than that, the people who the customer's buying from Santee Cooper ought to be paying that debt off and not getting the reactors. And that's not right. And that's why I say we either have to get the reactors and get the money back and don't pay any more in. Yes, sir. Mr. Cloud.
Listen, thank you, Governor, for that upbeat presentation, and we really appreciate it. And you mentioned about education and health care and economic development, and you know, I agree with that strongly. And I think those issues are inextricable. You can't, you know, separate them from each other. But Governor, in your state, education is really an issue. You know, we are losing a lot of young people. We're just not growing nearly as fast as we really should. And we are basically from a rural state, and a lot of those rural areas are just simply not being touched. You know, we have teacher shortage. I just want to hear something quickly, what you might have in mind, that we can really strengthen our rural areas. And of course, we want to bring in industry. And the last part of that, Governor, is that we do need marks in this area. We certainly hope that would be pushed.
No doubt about it. I'm 100% for the marks facility, and going to keep on pushing, even if we may have to bring a lawsuit. So the Attorney General has already brought a lawsuit one time on it, and the penalties for 2 years added $200 million a year already owed to us. But again, Mr. Cloud, I take it back to economic development. Economic development, a growing economy, and jobs are great. And that is the center of everything. But in order to do that, people have to get paid. I'm for more paychecks, bigger paychecks, and more of them. And what I've asked the legislature to do is cut the taxes on the people. Across the board, it's a 15% income tax cut over a period of 5 years on everybody in this room. Unless you're also a military veteran, a retired law officer, a retired peace officer, a retired first offender, retired sheriff, someone working for the government, that in those instances, and I said military retirees, you'll pay no income tax on your military retirement pay, on your law officer retirement pay. And we hope you go back to work and have another job in many more years, but we've got to keep the taxes as low as we possibly can, otherwise we're not going to happen. So again, it's essentially a question of economic development. I want to say this, we don't want to be hard on people. We understand that people need help. We understand people need to be safe. They expect to be safe, but they also expect their government to be frugal. And we just learned, Jerry Adjan just recently, in probation, pardon, and parole, instead of buying vehicles, he started renting them and got twice as many for half the money. Well, we need to move into an era of thriftiness. And we also, if we understand that people that need help, they need help from volunteer organizations. A lot of great volunteer organizations can help people when they're down. But also, if someone is getting government money, whether it's Medicaid or anything else, if you're able-bodied, you ought to be working. If the government is going to provide money for you, then you need to be working if you are able, and that's one thing that I'm going to do as well. So again, you ball it all up, we've got a great, great opportunity right now. It's as strong now as it has ever been. Everything is lining up. We have to be smart and not make any mistakes. Yes, sir.
Do you see an opportunity with infrastructure and job creation by finding a way to create a pipeline for people in those high poverty areas to work with the improvement of our infrastructure? So if you're thinking about the labor portion of it, is there a pipeline somewhere that you guys are looking to create?
Well, there is. Through the technical colleges, through all of the, there's a government website, there are different ways that people can find out about those kind of jobs. But what we've got right now is we've got 60,000 jobs out there right now that are looking for people. Usually we have people looking for jobs. We actually got over 60,000 right now. But they're looking for plumbers, they're looking for carpenters, they're looking for truck drivers. Did y'all know that a truck driver driving just in the state, driving one of these big trucks and in the state, maybe a couple of adjoining states, can make $100,000 a year doing that? I mean, there's a lot of very good jobs out there. We have training programs we're trying to get people into. But again, it's the development, it's the economic development. Spread it out, try to get it into these rural areas that's gonna make all the difference. We cannot make a company go to a particular place. They gonna pick the place, and because they're looking for what's most advantageous to them. There's just so much that we can give them to entice them to try to get them to go there. There's a limit on that. But again, what they're telling us is South Carolina has got the best people, and they want to come. It's gonna take a little longer to get to the rural areas. We encourage that growth there, and that's part of the program. But eventually, it's gonna take time and take a lot of energy.
Governor, we appreciate you being here today and all the positive things you've had to say about our community, and we want you to continue to think about us every morning. So we've given you this book from the Historic Aiken Foundation, and we hope that you'll keep it on your desk and think about us often when you're making big decisions and you're pointing people towards economic development. Send them to Aiken. We love to take care of them.
I got a question. Is that the best friend there? Is that train?
Yes.
It is?
Yeah.